Hey there, defender of the property. He's exhausted. this little booger, he runs more mileage in the first hour of the day than most people do all day long. He is on the job because there are bunnies everywhere and there are cats everywhere. You know what's weird? I haven't seen the white cat, the female. I think she had babies. I saw her a couple days ago, and she wasn't just pregnant. She was very pregnant. She was waddling around, and I've been feeding them extra food. I've been putting meat scraps into the cat bowl, and also I've been scrambling up eggs. I have extra eggs because my chickens are now laying. I like that. I like that because when the chickens are laying, there's an abundance of food, and the nice thing about it is I don't have to pay for this because the chickens are out free ranging. They're eating bugs and ants and spiders and greens and all kinds of stuff. Anything that falls out of the sky goes down into their little gullet, and they make eggs out of it. During the spring, in summer, I don't have to feed them that much. So my food costs go down, my egg production skyrockets, and the birds are a lot healthier. I like that. Well, what I've been doing is I've been scrambling up eggs. And what I do is I don't break them up really small. I leave them in large chunks. I put them into the cat bowl at night as soon as everybody goes to bed so the rascal doesn't sneak in there and eat their food. I put it in the cat bowl at night. The cats come in at night when it's safe. And what they're doing is they're grabbing a big chunk of scrambled egg and taking it back to where they live. This is kind of nice when the mother starts, "Hey, Tiki Dog, how you doing? You found me. Can't hide from you for very long." Anyway, what they do is they'll take it, the father cat will take a big chunk, take it to the mother, drop it off with her, and she can feed her babies scrambled eggs or meat scraps, whatever happens to be in the bowl. Because if there's just little cat food pieces in there, they can't really carry a mouthful of cat food back to the kittens. The kittens aren't really going to like that. So I'm trying to do the very best. Remember, I'm trying to do the very best I can in an imperfect situation. It seems to be working so far. Anyway, as the cats mature, I'll be showing you those. Also, as I capture them and take them in to get spayed or neutered, I'll also keep you updated on that. Well, today, aside from my rambling about the cats, today is weekend edition. You find me here right next to my old friend the tree. This tree was huge when I moved here, but it was a danger to the house. It had been planted many, many years ago, 100 years ago, too close to the house. The people back then didn't realize it was going to get so big and beautiful. During the windstorms, branches would fall on the house. I was concerned that this old monster was going to collapse on top of the house and kill me, so I had to have it cut down. Sad story that I had to have it cut down. The good part of it is all the parts of the tree were piled up behind you, if I could turn you around, into a huge wood pile. And that is where one of the cats lives, and also where bunnies and other kind of critters will live and be protected. It's a wildlife refuge. Also, from the top of it, I think you can see new branches are coming out. So new life springs out of this old tree. I have to be here because it's windy today, and unfortunately I can't be anywhere I want to be because the wind blows across this microphone and cuts off the sound really bad. And I don't want to have to film the whole program, go inside, find out that it's all kaput and have to do it again. So I'm going to do weekend edition right down here, if you don't mind, in the shade, in the grass, it's green, and answer your questions concerning gardening, life, love, the world, politics, religion, whatever you have. Well, maybe not politics and religion, but all the fun things in the world. If you have a question, I probably have an answer for that question. So without further ado, let's get started because I have a lot of questions and I have some really good ones this week. You're going to like this. You're going to like this a lot. We're going to start with Argent Draconis. Do you ever rotate your crops? That's a good gardening question. I get that every year. The answer is no, not on purpose. I may change areas where I plant my garden or plant the plants depending on how the weather conditions was, how it did the year before. But I don't rotate them in the sense that a lot of people will rotate their crops for fear of diseases setting in on a certain area and propagating throughout the years. That's the whole idea behind rotating crops, as well as nutrient deficiencies. For instance, a potato. If you plant that in an area, it sucks out certain types of nutrients, whereas kale may take out different types of nutrients. So if you plant potatoes here year after year, eventually your soil becomes depleted on certain nutrients, whereas the kale does the exact same thing. So if you switch them around, the potatoes will do well here because the kale didn't suck out the nutrients that the potatoes require, and vice versa. Well, I don't worry about that because of two things. First, I incorporate compost into my soil every single year, and that's a well-balanced fertilizer. It gives your plants and your soil everything that they need to grow big and healthy, so I don't have to rotate them for fear of lack of nutrients. Second of all, my plants don't get diseases. I know that sounds like a bit of an arrogant boast. It's just the truth. I don't boast, I just tell you what is. And what is I take care of my soil. My soil is healthy, my plants are healthy. I watch my plants to see what's going on. So I rarely have aphids, spider mites, sick plants, plants that drop dead. I don't have that issue. Generally, when you have issues with your plants, it stems from the soil. Unhealthy plants, they get sick. Healthy plants that are given the proper nutrition, they tend to stay healthier more. Not that they're immune, but they tend to resist it more. Just as if you exercise, eat well, have a great good frame of mind, you tend to be sick a lot less often than somebody that sits on the couch and eats Cheetos and plays war games all day long. Dig it in, Tiggy. You can dig anywhere you want. Yes, you can. This is your place. So no, I don't rotate, never had a problem. Julian, hey Julian. Hey Ray, my peppers are 8 inches tall and producing peppers, but it's early spring. Julian, you have a problem there. Actually, your plants have a problem, but it's not unsolvable. Your plants are producing early because there's an issue with their soil. Your plants should not be producing this early. Your plants should be growing at this stage in their life. And sometimes when a plant feels stressed or there's something lacking, what they want to do is their whole reason for existing is to reproduce. So if your plant is putting out flowers and peppers, probably smaller ones at this size, that means they want to propagate the species because they're not doing so well. That's what they do. They think, okay, I may not survive. I got to do what I got to do in order to make babies, and that's what they do. If your plant is healthy, it'll go through the growth cycle and then the reproductive cycle. I would check your soil. Something is lacking in there. I don't know how you're growing them, so I really can't guess on what's going on. But I can say that I would bet that it's your soil. So make sure that your peppers have deep, rich, well-drained soil, plenty of sunshine. If you have those four things, your peppers are going to do just fine. Check your stuff, okay? Next one, life in California, life in Cali for short. What should I do when my dog poops in my soil? He's been doing this for 6 months now. I'm upset, and rightfully so. I'm upset because I've been building soil fertility for 5 years now. Can you please help? Yes, I can. And this sounds like tough love, but sometimes you do need tough love. What you need to do is you need to train your dog. And these dogs seem to be very well behaved. They're gentle, they're mild. Look at them, not running off, not doing anything weird. And that's because I took the time, I took the effort, and I invested in my companions. I trained them. And you can do this with your dog as well. I'm not gonna fault you for your dog pooping in your garden. You probably didn't know that you can train your dog not to poop in your garden. Dogs like to poop. They like to pee, they like to mark stuff. That's a dog's nature. That's all well and good. But one thing that you need to understand is the nature of a dog. Dogs like to poop and pee in relatively the same spot. So what I would do, and this is what I've done before, I would scoop up their poop, put it on another side of the yard, far away from there as you can get, okay? Far enough away from there, if you have to, take your dog out on a leash when it goes outside to go to the bathroom. Take it to that spot where you've moved the poop and pee. Stay there with it, force it, and I'm not talking physical force, I'm just saying stand there and play the waiting game. That dog's gonna have to pee sometime, dog's gonna have to poop sometime. Get him to do it there. Pet them a little bit, congratulate them, give them a treat, bring them back inside. Let them know that they've done a good thing. It's called the carrot and the stick. If they go over towards your garden and you see them pooping and peeing, you say no in a loud, low voice. I don't want to say it now because my dogs know what that word means. You say it in a loud, low voice. No need for violence. You point at them, you let them know in a solid, stern voice that that is no, and they will know that. So that is the stick. That tells them that is bad. Take them to the good area, and then when they go to the bathroom there, give them the carrot. Give them the attention that they crave, the reinforcement that they need, and eventually your dog won't be pooing and peeing in your garden. Rascal and Tiki and Tanner, they go through my garden all the time. Not one of them has ever pooed and peed in my garden. They just don't do that. Next one, Aiden. Aiden is a friend on Facebook. He's a young guy, a young gardener, and I encourage people to get their kids started young. And Aiden wanted me to mention something that I thought was very important as well. You're probably, if you're seeing this program when it first comes out, it's on Easter. This program is airing on Easter Day. And if you're not seeing it on Easter, if you're seeing it later than that, this might help you for future holidays, okay? No matter what the holiday is, some people like to give puppies. They like to give puppies for presents. And I want to talk about that. Also on Easter, they like to give baby chicks. They like to give baby bunnies because it's a cute little Easter thing. I have something to say about that. I'm not going to tell you what to do or how to run your life. I'm going to give you just some information from my perspective because you tune in here for my perspective, and I appreciate that. I respect the fact that you have my opinion weighs on you a little bit in a positive way. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask you that you might want to consider not doing this, okay? A birthday is a horrible time. Christmas is a horrible time to be giving pets. Easter is a bad time to be giving pets. It's a holiday season. It's a holiday thing, whether it's birthday, Christmas, you name it, to be giving animals as gifts. An animal is a companion. It's not a toy. It's not a gift. It's a companion that you're giving to somebody. And I would first check and see if they want a companion. Does your child want a companion? Educate them. Educate yourself first. And then educate them as to what is required to care for and keep this companion. Is your child, are you prepared for this level of commitment? They're a living, breathing creature of this earth. And they deserve the minimum of courtesy and respect that all living creatures deserve, and that is quality care, because you're the one who decides whether they live or die. Quality food, you decide what their nutrition is. You make the decisions for these creatures. And so it's your responsibility. With the benefits of their companionship comes the responsibility of their care, well-being. Will you love them? Will you care for them during the good times and the bad times? A baby chick, it's very cute, especially when they dye them colors. But the whole concept of giving peeps, chickens as gifts, ducks and rabbits, these creatures after the holiday season are going to grow up. They're not going to be cute little pets anymore. What are you going to do with them? Chicks, they need companionship. They're flock creatures. You got to understand this. They need more than just themselves. They're going to be lonely. They're going to be miserable. They may peck the ground and walk around normal, but their life is not supposed to be just the minimum. It's supposed to be decent and good. Same thing with rabbits. What are you going to do with them after that? Put them in a little tiny hutch? Would you like to be in a little tiny hutch? Would any creature like to be in a little tiny hutch with nothing but a food bowl and some sawdust to live out their lives? Is that the kind of life that you want to give an animal? These are just concerns that I want to bring to your attention so that you'll make an informed decision. And if we forego buying these things that the marketing people put out there for us on holidays, that's just one less animal that's purchased. It takes one step to start a journey. It takes one less purchase to start a movement. And eventually, if enough people say, no, I'm not going to do this on the holidays, eventually they're not going to be offering these creatures on the holidays. And that's a good thing, because creatures should be brought into your life as companions on an educated level basis. Okay, that's what I wanted to bring to your attention. I want to thank Aiden for bringing that to my attention so that I can bring it to yours. Okay, let's get on with this. Lisa, good morning, Lisa. Hi, Ray. Can you tell me why my watermelons weren't sweet at all? Yes, I can. I mentioned this on another program on Weekend Edition. It's the word is called terroir. Okay, see how I just kind of fluently, I kind of do that like I'm selling a car. Terroir, that is the environment, the sun, the air, the soil, the water, everything that goes into that plant gives it the flavor, the texture, all the good things. Now, of course, your plant is going to give you the basics. If you plant a watermelon seed, you're probably going to get a watermelon. And a lot of the flavor and size and shape and everything have to do with the genetics of that. But you can influence it to a degree with what's called terroir. And that's their environment. Environment has a lot to do with things. If you grow it in crappy soil, you may not get a delicious flavor. If you grow it in with a different kind of fertilizer, you may not get the best flavor. Your best bet when you're growing these things, give them, and I sound like a broken record, and I'm okay with it. Rich, watermelons love rich, well-drained soil and plenty of it. They love nutrition because think about it, that little vine is putting out that big, huge, honking leviathan of a fruit. It needs to be supported. So what it needs is a good, solid place to put down its roots. It needs plenty of sun. It needs no competition for the nutrients that are in that soil. And also, find a brand that's good. I'm growing one this year, and I'll finally tell you what it is. It's called Bradford. Bradford watermelon. I researched them and I found out that Bradford, I also sell a watermelon seed. It's, what is it called? Congo. Congo is a good one as well. But I decided to go, I could only do one. I wanted to try Bradford and see if that was as good as Congo. Congo's good. It's got a good sweet flavor, the old-fashioned long watermelons. I'm not trying to promote the seed site. I'm just telling you, Congo's a good one. Also, Bradford, but they are very rare. The seeds are very rare. I'm going to grow it. I'm going to taste it right here on the program if I can get it to produce watermelons. I'm going to give you my honest opinion, and if it does well, I'm going to save some of the seeds. So I'll let you know how that goes, okay? Christine and Dragonfly Neb, both of them, I combined their question because they had the same question. They wanted to know about my clippers that I was using in my program last week, what brand they are, and because they liked them. I'm going to tell you what these are, but I'm not going to endorse them for you to buy them. The name is Felco, Felco, and the model number is F12, okay? These were a birthday present from Mike, my best friend. And he got these for me because he knew that I can't seem to find a good pair of clippers. And the ones that I was using, they keep going dull or they'll start squeaking really bad. This brand is known for high quality. They're made in Sweden, I believe. And Swedish people, they know how to build stuff. I got to give it to them. Swedish people, German people, they are two cultures that are really big on quality. And I got to tip my hat to them. These ones are not inexpensive, but not this model number, but Felco makes inexpensive ones as well, and those are going to be good quality. Now, what the quality is, it's the blade. I'm not going to drag this up close to show you. Actually, why? Of course I am. Why wouldn't I? These are kind of old. I've had them for a few years. I've used them a lot. They're called Felco. They open and close with an inner spring mechanism, which I like, and they have a little lever that you can do that, and they won't open up. That way you can carry them in your pocket or carry them in your hands. And some of them, when you do that lever, if you squeeze them, they open up. These ones will not, so that you don't have to worry about your kids grabbing these and opening them up and hurting themselves. Do that. Now, what's nice about this is I've been using these for 2 to 3 years, I think 2 years, and the blade is still almost razor sharp. That is quality built. Now, they also, one thing that you may or may not like is the handle here. Half the handle turns like that, 180 degrees. And that's for when you're doing these, you can see it, they kind of roll in the top part of my hand. This part rests ergonomically against your thumb. This part rolls in your hand. This is a lot different from other types of pruners, and you may not like this. It took me a while to get used to this, and after a while, I liked it. Because other ones that don't, they can rub up against your hands and you get blisters. Yeah. So, yes, Felco F12. Now, other Felcos are going to be just as good, so don't worry about the price of these. I know that a lot of people can't afford them, and that's okay. But these were a birthday present for me, and he knew I wanted something good. So he saved up his money, and he bought these for me, and it was a very nice, thoughtful present for me. But other Felcos are going to have the same quality blades, so if you want to get a less expensive one, I would definitely suggest that. Those are decent. Now this is not decent. This is a sprayer that I purchased from Walmart. And of course, you know, you do get what you pay for in this world. Nothing is for free. You pay either in quality or you pay in money. There's always a balance going on with this, okay? And sometimes you may slip underneath the wire, but most of the times, karma's gonna get you with this. Now, this is inexpensive. This is a sprayer. You can turn the nozzle and get all different spray patterns. It's really wonderful. And you have a little handle right here. It's all well and good. The first one that I got many, many years ago, I loved it. It had an aluminum tube, and this was aluminum. Very good quality. It worked for the longest time. Well, eventually it broke. And you can't help that. Hey, Mike's home. He takes off every day. Whenever you order seeds from the website, I package them up that night, and Mike goes out the very next day. He hops in the car. He drives all the way to Exira, and he's the one that mails your seeds. So if you ever order from the site, That's the guy who's delivering your seeds to the post office. Anyway, he's back, so I'll be talking to him soon. Anyway, this, it eventually broke, so I went to Walmart and I got one, another one. Well, it turns out that whatever country used to make the ones that I used to get doesn't exist anymore. And now, hey, Tiki. Hi, smell my cheapness. Yeah, that's cheap. This one's made out of plastic, and so is this. I've only had this thing, I've only used it 2 times. And I went to go water the animals 2 days ago, and I turned on the handle, and this just flew right off. It flew across the yard, and I had to go chase after it, and I got water flying out of here. Piece of crap. Well, I used what's called JB Weld to weld this back together, because I'm not giving up on this thing. I paid for this. I'm going to use it. If I have to weld this thing together, I will. So, yeah, there are good things, there are bad things. The good things tend to cost a little bit more money, but as a wise person once told me, the cheap comes out expensive. It does. Next one, Sarah. Hi, Sarah. All right, on with Weekend Edition. Anyway, if you want to take a break, pause the video, go grab yourself a cup of coffee, go grab yourself a kid, the dogs, the cats, bring them on over here, because this is a family-friendly channel, family-friendly program, and you don't ever have to worry about anything here, okay? We're all friends. Next one comes from Sarah. Hi, Sarah. We just bought our... Oh, you know what? I think the wind just stopped. Let's get out of the shade and go sit in the sun, shall we? I think that'll be fun. Oh, yeah. That's much better. It's warmer over here. Okay, let's get back to Sarah's question. Sarah says, we just bought our first home. Hey, congratulations on just over half an acre. It's a blank slate. Just grass. We are also on a septic system, which is a first for us. I've been reading about planting native perennials over the leach bed to help with irrigation. Any tips? Are you on a septic? I'm worried about damaging the drain pipes if I pick something with too invasive of the roots. I'm in zone 5B. I also want to put in a large veggie garden, but I'm struggling to figure out how far away the veggie gardens need to be from a septic leach bed. Any insight or advice would be appreciated. Thanks. Now, I'm going to answer that question, Sarah, but also I'm going to add another one because Linda has a question as well. Okay, so I'm going to add you both together and answer both of your questions at once, okay? Linda said, I planted apple trees near a septic area like 20 feet from my leach field. Do I cut the apple trees down? Because she's afraid that she planted them too close. And gardening in that area, I want to plant asparagus. I'm treating the tank by putting yeast down the bathroom drains and we'll also get some natural septic stuff. It costs more, but it's supposed to work the best. Now I want to answer both of those questions, okay? But I also want to take you on a little trip over here so that you can see what I'm talking about. This right here is what's called a septic tank. For those of you who don't know what a septic tank is, I'm going to give you just like a 1 minute thing on this, okay? And also to answer the questions. What happens when you live in the country? You don't have sewer pipes. In the city, you flush your toilet and you never think about it. In the country, out in the rural areas, we have to think about it because we have to process our sewage ourselves. There's nobody here to help us. So how it works is, there's the house. There's a toilet in the house and also drains from sinks and showers and stuff. Well, when all the stuff comes out of there, it comes through a pipe that's underneath the ground about 3 to 4 feet. It comes out of the house, out of the basement, and it comes over to here. This is what's called a septic tank. There's 2 tanks in a septic tank. The first one is for everything to go into, the water, the solids, you name it, you know, all that fun stuff. And what that does is it sits there. And there are bacteria, there are fungi, there's all different kinds of stuff that breaks down the toilet paper, the solids, all of that stuff. It breaks it down into like a sludge, but a liquidy sludge, okay? That's what they do, the microbes. And then what they have is an overflow in that tube. When it fills up, there's a tube where just the liquids, not the solids, the liquids will come through and go into this tank. And so this is all just like compost tea in a way. This further ferments and breaks down even more. And then when this fills up, it gently goes out into your drain field. My drain field is where the driveway is and beyond. This whole area here is a drain field, yes. And those pipes, what they do is when the pipe comes out, it's a big round tube, it'll split off into a whole bunch of different ones. And what they do is they put down sand, and then rock, like on my driveway, these big pieces of rock, lay the tubes on them, put more rock over it, more sand, and then dirt over that. So your tubes are more than likely, especially in your area, they got to be below frost line. Otherwise, they would freeze, and any liquids that came out of there would freeze to ice, and it would clog up your septic. So what they do is they put them way down there. They're going to be 3 to 4 feet below the surface of the soil. Okay, I wanted to let you know that first, and then we'll get to the rest of it. Well then, now you know a little bit more about poo than you ever wanted to know. Well, what that does is the liquid, without any of the solids, goes into those pipes that come out here, and they have holes in them about as big around as your little finger. The liquids go out and they go down. They don't go up or anything. They go down into the rock and filter down into the soil gradually, and it goes way down into the soil. So what most people will do is they'll plant grass over their drain field. And you don't have to care for it, you just have to mow it. And you can drive over it. Heck, you could drive a car over your drain field if you wanted to. I wouldn't recommend it, but you can. My car is parked right on my drain field. I don't have a problem with that because I know that structurally it's not gonna hurt it because the pipes are so far down. Now, what most people will do is just plant grass over it. Nothing with really deep roots, because you don't want the roots going in there and getting into those tubes, because they can clog them up. If that happens, you have to tear up the whole drain field and put in a new one. We're talking multiple thousands of dollars to do that. Not a good thing. All the stink, all the mess, no. That's a bozo no-no. So we care for our system, so our system will care for us. All right? The drain field. Plant grass on it, or you can plant perennials that don't have deep roots. I can't tell you which because I really don't know off the top of my head. I don't plant anything on top of my drain field except grass. I even have my compost pile over here. But that's what you do for your drain field. As far as doing raised beds, you don't have to worry about putting raised beds near your drain field because it doesn't come up. And I wouldn't put an in-ground garden near my drain field because you never know how deep the roots of the plants are gonna go, okay? Now, raised beds around your drain field, not a problem at all. Now, some people even put raised beds on their drain field. I'm not telling you what to do, I'm just telling you what they do because they build soil on top of it and people may think, ooh, no, no, poop. Like I said, the slurry, the liquids from your drain tubes goes down. It doesn't come up, okay? It doesn't do that. So if you put raised beds on top of there and put soil in, you're gonna be watering your plants and that goes down. It doesn't come up, okay? So you're gonna be perfectly safe. It can be done, it can touch the soil, not a problem at all. Now, that being said, I wouldn't do it. In case you ever have to deal with your drain field, you'd have to tear out your raised beds. You can put it next to it, not a problem at all. That's not going to hurt it at all. As far as your apple trees aren't going to send in roots 20 feet into your drain field, not in our lifetime, okay? If you keep your apple trees pruned down and don't let them get really monstrous, they're going to be just fine. I wouldn't worry about it myself. Some people may worry about it. I personally would not because the apple trees are there and generally they're not going to do a lot of damage to your drain field at that distance. 20 feet? No. If they were 5 or 10 feet, I'd probably take them out of there. But things like willows. Willows are a taboo when it comes to drain fields because they will seek and destroy any kind of water source because they have long roots that will travel for like a million miles to get to water. That's a no-no. Don't ever plant anything like that. No trees on top of your drain field. Don't do it. Now, as far as treating your drain tank and stuff, you know what? It's a myth. And they try to sell you products. Yeast, Radix, all those enzymes that they say dump into your toilet and flush down. You don't need that because you know what? It comes from here. You have bacteria. You have yeast. You have a fungi in your system that you pass with everything that goes down the toilet. You have digested this. You have chemicals that digest this stuff in your system. And when you flush that, it's going into the system and it works in the system. You are the one that's inoculating your system with the enzymes and the bacteria that are required to break that down. You never, ever have to add anything. So if you're buying stuff, I would suggest don't ever buy it. What you need to do with your drain, with your septic tank, for those of you who have septic tanks, once a year or once every 2 years, have a septic pumper come out. They'll take the lid off. They will drain both your tanks down to nothing. For me, it costs $175, and that will ensure that a lot of stuff doesn't build up into your tank, because a lot of people will use a lot of toilet paper. They're flushing things that shouldn't be flushed. You have to take extra special care when you have a septic tank. You don't flush as often, you don't use as much toilet paper, and you don't put paper towels or tampons or anything else, plastic, cigarette butts, nothing like that, because it's not like in the city where you flush it and it disappears. This is going to stay there, okay? And you can damage your system, and it costs up to $12,000 for a new system. So take care of your tank, and your tank will take care of you. Not bad. I've learned over the years, because I have made a lot of mistakes with septic systems, so I know my septic systems. Gary! Hey, Gary. Hey, Ray. What garden plants grow in shady places in the yard? I can't seem to find anything on the internet. Well, I think my viewers can help you with that. I have a lot of gardeners out there, so gardeners, I'm going to ask you if you would help Gary. I could list a couple of them, but I think this is a fun one that we can all participate in. What, and we all have different growing areas and different challenges, anybody that has a shaded garden, I would appreciate it if you would just chime in, post it in the comment section below, and tell Gary what grows well for you. Now, I'm going to ask you, please, don't go researching and looking all over the internet. I want your experience, because you do have experience. I know you do. Okay? So what have you personally grown in a shady area with success in your garden? Those of you who have answers, please help Gary out, okay? I'm going to let you guys take care of this one for me, if you would, if you don't mind. Next one is from Baby. Some of the crankiest people I've ever encountered online is in the plant-related groups on Facebook. I've sat there many times and wondered, do plants make you cranky, or are cranky people attracted to plants? That's not a question, that was a comment, and I had to include that here, because I, of all people, know how cranky people can get. I've been in the gardening business since way, way back when, and my first foray into gardening wasn't on YouTube. No, it wasn't. You know what it was? It was onto gardening groups. There was one called Garden Web. I think it now is called Hose or Hose or H-O-U-Z-Z. It used to be called Garden Web. That was a troll paradise. And also, I think one was called Tomatoville. There is, a Tomatoville that sells tomato seeds, but this isn't that one. This is a garden group called Tomatoville. What happened is, I'll keep it short. I went to join these gardening groups so I could connect with other gardeners, because this is after my breakdown, and I was trying to connect with people so that I could reintegrate myself in with the human beings. I thought, what better way than gardening? Because we all have something in common. We can all share something that's fun and good. I went on to there, and people would ask questions like, how do I take care of my tomato? And I would answer a question. And I did this on Tomatoville. Somebody asked a question. I answered that question, and another person came over and started yelling at me. So I told him, I said, why don't you mind your own business, you douchebag? I wasn't talking to you. It's none of your business. If you want to be miserable, go be miserable on your own time. And I got banned from that group. They tossed me out on my tail. So, no, because I don't appreciate people being treating other people poorly. If I'm not talking to you and I'm not asking for your opinion, then I don't necessarily welcome your opinion, okay? If I want your help, I can ask for your help. I'm a big boy now. Somebody asked me a question. Somebody asked a question. I answered their question. You could have answered their question. You didn't need to respond to me. Okay, that's a little bit rude. And next one, so I got tossed out of there. I thought, well, that was kind of abrupt. So I left that, and I even did a program on there. It's called I Got Banned, and I talk about that. So, and then I went on to a Garden Web. Same thing happened. This is after I had my Practice 5572 channel. Somebody asked a gardening question, a very simple one, and I answered them. And it was about compost. And boy, did I get raked over the coals. I got beat up so bad, I thought, you know what? Never again. So now I have my own gardening community on Facebook and also on YouTube. And we share ideas. We don't always agree. You know we don't. But as long as we agree to disagree with respect, courtesy for the other person and the other person's ideas, everybody's happy. I'm happy. But when you come at me with something negative like, don't do that, or you need to do this, that's not respectful. That's not courteous, okay? And when you badmouth other people, that's not courteous as well, and I have to intervene. So yes, I am the moderator of this little world that I call my gardening community, but the only thing that I require, and I don't back down on it, is you treat others with courtesy. If you do that, you can disagree all you want. You can debate all you want, but you have to bring it with a level of of courtesy and respect for the other person. If you can't bring that, then don't bring it at all. Go on your merry way and go somewhere else. But no, I don't fit in garden communities. I've tried it on Facebook too, and I got beat up on there because I don't accept that, and I don't allow people to do that to me or to my friends. And that's something that I think other gardening communities could look into. It always seems like there's a few people on there that are I call them the trolls, because they just sit there and their answers are the only answers. And if anybody has anything different, they tend to beat them up. And they've been on there a long time, or they run the gardening group. And that's not right. You shouldn't be doing that to people. Next one is from Janie. Hey, Janie. Hey, Ray. You do know that blue hydrangeas aren't normal, right? Okay, well, that came from my wish of someday, and my goal of someday having a blue hydrangea. I said, I always wanted blue hydrangeas. Well, I should have clarified myself, and sometimes when I don't clarify myself, people get the wrong impression. I didn't mean to say that there are hydrangeas that are naturally blue. I do understand that hydrangeas are either blue or they're yellow, depending on, or is it, no, pink, depending on the pH of the soil. I understand that. I accept that. I want blue hydrangeas. So I'm going to buy a hydrangea that can turn blue or is already blue, and then I'm going to keep it blue. That's what I meant, okay? So I don't want any misunderstanding. I do understand there's a difference, and actually they are normal, to disagree with you. They are normal. It's just they're normal in a different pH, okay? So anybody that had any kind of confusion on that, I'm really sorry. Next one, Kenny. Hey, Kenny. That's my nephew's name. Hey, Ray. How come you only grow on such a limited area? You could build double the garden beds and harvest double the produce before winter and grow even more different plants than you do now. Is it because of the time involved with maintaining the plants, or just because you're happy with the current size? Actually, you were right there. I grow for the fun of it. I love getting tomatoes. I love getting radishes. I love getting peppers, all the fun stuff to eat. But the core of what I do is for the fun. I enjoy it. I enjoy watching them grow, watching them sprout, seeing the harvest, taking care of them, seeing what I can do to help them do what they do best, and that's to grow and provide food. I do it for the fun of it. I used to grow a much bigger garden, and I did that for a sustenance garden, for a sustenance garden because I wanted a lot of food. I don't do that anymore. As I get a little bit older, I cut back just a little bit more so I can have time to spend with my dogs, time to spend with myself, and not focus so much energy on my garden. I could grow a ton of food here, but that would be a gargantuan amount of effort. And FedEx is here. Hold on a second. I got something coming in from FedEx. I'll be right back with you, okay? Aha! You're right. It's in! only a gardener can get excited about getting in some fence wire in. I got chicken wire. I found it on sale, and I had to buy some chicken wire because I'm doing a project. And don't worry, you'll be in on this too. But the FedEx driver, I scared the daylights out of him, poor guy. Because I'm usually inside doing something, and he drops off the package at the front door. So I went over there, I walked next to his truck, and he opens up the door, and he goes, oh! I didn't expect to see anybody. So, yeah, I got my chicken wire. It's a good day. It's a really good day. Okay, let's get back to everybody's stuff, okay? Because you got things to do, and I want to finish this up. Okay, but to finish off with Kenny, I only grow for the fun of it, and so I don't want to spend too much time growing that stuff because it would take a lot of compost. It would take a lot of time, and I'd like to do other things, too. I love to garden, but I don't want it to nail me down, okay? And gardens, those of you who garden, you know they can be a lot of responsibility to keep them weeded, to keep them cared for, fenced in. And I got rabbits everywhere. I have to fence everything in. And that's a lot of fencing. And this is just a little bit of fencing, and it costs me enough money as it is. I do not have a lot of money to be spending on this kind of stuff. And actually, that's coming up in another question. Mary! Good morning, Mary. Hi, Ray. My compost takes forever to break down. I have a pile and a compost bin. I try to include both brown and green matter, and by brown and green matter, she means brown as in a carbon source, green as in a nitrogen source. That's what basically compost is, and I'll get into that in just a second. I try to include brown and green matter and turn it regularly, but I'm not quite sure what the ratio should be. What do you suggest? I've seen gardening videos where people bury their kitchen scraps in the soil, and it breaks down much more quickly. Do you recommend doing that instead of the pile and bin? I'm an experienced gardener, but I just can't seem to make enough compost to use in my garden. I'd love to know what I can do to change that. Well, Mary, and anybody else, this is a concern that a lot of people have. How can I enrich my soil? Because here's Ray just spouting off about compost this and compost that. I can't possibly get enough compost. Yes. Yes, you can. Save your kitchen scraps. Anything but meat and fats and stuff like that. Vegetables, coffee grounds. Coffee grounds are good. Anything that you can compost down, do a compost bin, do a compost pile. Mary, you're doing fine, okay? That compost will break down. Not like mine, my monster pile that heats up, you know, like a volcano, because I have a lot of nitrogen in mine and I pile it up high and it's chicken manure, so it's going to do hot composting. Compost will break down even if it doesn't heat up. It just has less of those bacteria helping them out, and it's not so much of a nuclear reactor, and it just takes a little bit more time. And sometimes it uses fungi to break it down instead of the thermophilic bacteria that I use, okay? And so you do that. And also, here's another trick that you can do. If your compost isn't finally broken down by the end of the season, and you do have it like an off season for months where you're not gardening, here's what you do. I've mentioned this before, I'll mention it again. What you do is you dig rows deep into your garden, like maybe a foot down, as wide as you can, lay on this kitchen scraps. If you got kitchen scraps, even if they're not broken down, chop them up like banana peelings and eggshells and coffee grounds and lettuce and weird stuff like that. Chop it all up, lay it in into a layer, and then cover it with soil. If you got a lot of it, lay it down, cover it with a few inches of soil, lay down another few inches of soil, water it, leave it. Walk away, go have a good day, go have a nice dinner, and you know what? Next spring, when the planting season comes, you just dig all that soil around, and guess what? It's all going to be broken down, because those microbes in the soil are going to do for you what the stuff does for me in my compost pile. You're going to have compost in your soil, okay? It may not look exactly like this compost, but it's going to be just as good nonetheless. Also, if your compost isn't finished breaking down by the end of the season, do the exact same thing. Dig those trenches, dump the stuff in there. The trick is, don't put a big old long wad of a row in there. You want to make sure that the soil sandwiches it, and it's a thin layer of stuff that needs to be broken down along with a thick layer of soil. Moisten it so that it can let the bacteria and those fungi leach into the material. Worms will help you as well in that process. So that's what you can do to increase your capacity for fertilizing your garden. That's what you do. Also, if you have a lawn, not everybody does have a lawn, but if you do have a lawn and you mow it, if you have a bagger, catch that green grass when you mow it, side dress your plants as they're growing. The grass is high in nitrogen while it's green. The nitrogen in grass and other green matter is water soluble. So as it leaches down and you water your garden, as it leaches through the grass, it's going to fertilize your garden. Worms, they love grass. They like nothing more than grass and leaves. Grass is a wonderful thing. It's going to bring those worms up. They're going to chew it up. And where the grass meets the soil, the bacteria is going to break it down little by little, and it's going to virtually disappear as time goes on. At the end of the season, dig it all in. Whatever's left over, leave it there over the winter. Lots of fun stuff can be done to help your soil fertility. Those are just some of the ideas. I hope that they'll work for you guys. If you have any questions about that, ask me in the comment section below. I will always answer your questions, and I'll go into as much depth as you want me to. Next one, Gail. Hey, Gail. Hey, Ray. Oh, she asked, hey, Ray, I thought I was rereading the same question. Hey, Ray, now that spring's in the air, are the chickens laying more eggs? Yes, they are. They are laying like gangbusters. They weren't laying during the winter, which is good, because in the winter, the eggs freeze before I can get at them. So what I do is I cut back their food so they have just enough to supply them with just enough calories to stay warm and healthy. Then when spring comes along, they have that food, and yellow wing and red wing blackbirds are showing up. You can hear them. It's just a wonderful cornucopia of sounds and smells and sights out here. But anyway, the chickens go out there and they start eating the bugs and the grass, and that boosts their nutrition. And chickens are a wondrous thing. If you put more nutrition into them than they can use, out come the eggs. That's what they do. And now I'm getting about 5 eggs a day. I have like 9 hens. They don't lay an egg a day, but almost an egg a day. So I get about 4 or 5 eggs a day, which is way more than we can eat. So now I have 2 18 packs of eggs in my fridge, plus a dozen a pack on top of that. And I just made egg salad and potato salad and deviled eggs yesterday. So yeah, we're full of eggs. But the nice thing is I can always use them to feed the cats, to feed the dogs. I never have a problem getting rid of my eggs. And also, Mike's friends at Walmart, we take in dozens of eggs and we give them to them for free. I don't sell them because $1 or $2, it's not something, I know it's money and I can use the money, but I prefer to give them as gifts because it really does make them happy. And so that's just my way of giving. Next one, Spartan. Hey, Spartan. I have root aphids. Oh, I've heard of root aphids. I have root aphids in my indoor pots, and I'm wondering if neem oil will take care of these plant-ruining boogers. They only seem to affect the softer stem plants like my potatoes and tomatoes. They are turning the stems of my potatoes to mush, and the structural integrity is completely compromised, and the plant just collapses. And when I pull the dying ones out, the stems are just mushy and yucky like they're rotted. Well, I can tell you, you have two problems. Yes, you do, Spartan. You have, of course, if you've seen them, you can see what the root aphids look like. They're just little tiny boogers, like little mites that are eating away at the roots. They can damage your plants. If you mix up neem, like you were mentioning, and use it as a soil drench, it will kill those. Not a problem. Okay, that problem's solved. You have another problem. Root aphids do not cause a stem to be mushy. I've had that happen when I had a plant store called Gumby's Garden when I had it in Denver. I had an epidemic going through my plants. Usually the philodendrons had this, but other plants got it as well, like the Dieffenbachias. Their stems or their leaf stems would turn to this mush, watery mush. And you may have seen this on your plants, and sometimes the leaves would get watery spots. This is a fungus that you're having, okay? This is a fungus. This has nothing to do with those. You need to get a fungicide of your choice. I won't recommend any, but any fungicide will deal with this, okay? And by the way, neem is a good fungicide, but don't mix it as strong as you normally would. Do it like half strength, put it in a spray ball, shake it up really well, and mist your plants. The underside, the top side, don't drench them too much, just mist them good, the stems and the soil surface, and then leave it. Okay, you don't want to use this very often, maybe once every 2 to 3 weeks, because neem can sometimes be harsh on plants that are stressed. And if your plants are collapsing, they're stressed. That's a weird thing. You want to treat a plant, but usually if a plant is ailing, the stuff that you use to treat them can actually harm them even further. It's a weird situation. So you got to play the balancing game. Next one. Oh, last page. Here we go. True Grit. Where did you get your socks? I'm looking. Yeah, he said socks. I'm looking all around for those kind. I used to buy those from Shopko and TJ Maxx, but they don't carry that type anymore. Well, he was talking about when I was in the Voodoo Garden, my socks. Yes, my socks. And there you go. They're white socks. They're ankle high. I can't believe I'm showing my feet. And they got the gray on the bottom. That's the reinforcing part. They're very comfortable. They're cotton. And they are sold at Super Shop store. I'm going to put a link below this program, okay? I'm not endorsing this place, but I did look it up. I got them at Walmart, but a lot of people don't like Walmart. That's fine. And also, Walmart changes their selection all the time, so I can't guarantee they're going to be there, but I can guarantee they're going to be at this link that I'm going to post down here. And actually, the price wasn't bad, so if you want to buy them there, that's fine. And they're called Gildan, G-I-L-D-A-N, Gildan socks, and they're the heavy-duty ones. And they've got support on the bottom. They're thicker. They don't tear when your toenails get a little bit too long. Wonderful socks. That's all I ever wear. And they're comfortable, too. And they're cotton. All right, next one. Here I am doing sock commercials. G.D. Marley. Hi. Our Mary Washington asparagus we bought from you is about 1 month old. Oh, they bought asparagus seeds from me. I have a shop. I'll mention this really quick. I have a shop called the Little Shop of Seeds. Yeah, that's the name of my little seed shop. I actually sell garden vegetable seeds. I sell a small selection, about maybe 48 different types of seeds, and every month I'm trying to add more and more. As I get more sales, I buy more varieties to add to it. I just started this not too long ago. Well, what I do is I sell them for 55 cents a pack. And you may think, they're probably rejects or not as good as other seeds, or there's not as many. Wrong. They are as good quality or better than what you're going to find anywhere else. I only source fresh seeds, okay? And the companies that I trust. And I also look online. and I take samplings of other seed stores. Whether their seeds are $1, $2, $3, $4, I find out how many seeds they are including in there, and I match that or exceed that. So you are getting as many seeds or more than any other website, the quality as is good or better than any other website, 55 cents across the board, any seed I sell. From asparagus to tomatoes of all different types to lettuces, kale, you name it, it's there. And if it's there, it's 55 cents. The thing is, I just don't charge as much. And so I don't make as much money, which is kind of unfortunate, but my plan is you're going to like them so much, you're going to tell your friends, you're going to post it on gardening groups, you're going to help me out that way because I helped you out this way. And I don't put on I don't put them in fancy packaging. I put them in little Ziploc plastic bags that you can reuse, and I just put the name on there. If you need any other kind of instructions, you can find them online. That's the balance of it. You get them inexpensive, but you don't get all the weird frills. And in the end, all we want is the seeds anyway. So if you want to check it out, I always put the links below my programs. If you like it, please spread the word. It would really help me out, okay? Back to the question after that commercial. Anyway, after 1 month, it took a while for them to come up, and asparagus can take a while to come up. Now, while some of them are still small, others are 7 inches tall and they're starting to bend. Should we plant them outside? Have a great day, Ray. Yes, plant them outside. Asparagus can take the cold. All right, I wouldn't suggest putting them out there if it's freezing or frost, but if the frost is over, get them out there right away. Plant them in rich, well-drained soil. Asparagus needs that rich soil. Make sure you put compost or compost and manure in there. Plant them in there, get them outside. They can, even when they're just barely sprouted, they can go outside. Do it now. Okay, next one, music cliche, a regular on this channel, and he or she always has fun questions, and I do appreciate that. Ray, how do you keep your raised beds from rotting? The wood on my raised beds. That's a good question. And the answer to that is very simple. I don't do anything. I use untreated wood. I don't want to use treated wood. That's just my preference. Some people use treated wood. It lasts a lot longer, and it is known to be safe by some folks. Some folks say it's not safe. I'm not going to get involved in that because there's information both ways. But it does tend to side on the safe because they've changed the formula of what they used to treat it with. Then again, some organic gardeners may not want to put that kind of wood in their garden. That's up to you. I use untreated because that's my preference. 2x10s, and I make them a double size, so they're 2x20s. That's a nice deep pile, a nice deep bed. I can pile on the soil really deep. And I put a lot of compost in there. There's a lot of microorganisms. It's moist soil. And what it does is, little by little, over the years, the wood is slowly going to decompose because that's just the nature of life. The soil will take back everything into itself. It'll take back the trees that are growing, the wood that's on the ground. It takes our bodies. The earth will take back what is its. So, what is its? What is hers? I think that's a little bit better. What is hers? She will take back what is hers. And that includes the wood. But since it's 2 inches thick, it's going to take forever for it to rot all the way through. And so for my amount of time that I'm going to be gardening for 10 to 20 more years, that's going to be just fine. So I have no worries at all with that. That's a weird sound. Okay. The second half of the question, and this was an important one. Did you have any passive income before you retired? Well, I've told people that I retired back in 2007. And I didn't technically retire, as in get Social Security and quit the workforce. What I did was I had a mental breakdown, a physical breakdown, and a suicide attempt. I know that sounds really ridiculous, but it's true. That's my life. That's what happened. What I did was I overworked myself, and I developed clinical depression at the same time, undiagnosed. I had no idea. The combination of the stress, the overwork, and the clinical depression, it caused me to go down a dark path. And I've mentioned that in my book, and I've mentioned that on programs, Coming Back from the Edge. And I brought myself back little by little with the help of myself, my best friend, and everything around me, and the garden. And that's why I value gardening so much. I brought myself back. But one of the trade-offs of this was I recognize my weaknesses. And that's something that people should be able to do. When you want to develop your wisdom, develop the ability to know what your weaknesses are, what your strengths are, what things you can change, what things you cannot change. And I finally developed that wisdom. And I realized I don't have that middle ground that some people have. I either go all out or I don't. And with business, I went all out. I gave 101% of myself. And what that did was it drained me, literally drained me like you're wringing out a sponge. And there was nothing left inside me to take care of myself. And so I suffered for that. Now, what I had to do was I couldn't keep my businesses because I couldn't run them without doing that again. And next time I wouldn't be so lucky as to survive. I divested myself of all of my holdings, all of my business, all of my everything in order to save my life. What that did was it left me relatively broke. People might think, well, you had all that money. Well, I did have a lot of money, but I didn't plan on almost dying from it, so I didn't save up for a rainy day. I just saved up a little bit of money into my savings account, and I lived off of that for the next year. Mike got a part-time job because that's about all you can get in a small town like that. He got a part-time job to help out as best as he could. Between both of those things, we didn't have enough money to get by, so we had to sell the 80-acre farm that we lived on and get out of there before we went bankrupt, and we moved into a smaller place, and then we moved from that place to here, all right? And so this place we own outright, and that's because it was so inexpensive that we could afford to pay for it, so we don't have to make as much money as we did before, but we still have to make money. You gotta pay property taxes, you gotta buy food, you gotta take care of these animals to the best of your ability. You have to do, you know, you have to pay for all your bills, and there's a lot of bills even without the mortgage. So what I do is, I don't have a lot of money. And that's one thing that people make the mistaken impression of, is that people that do YouTube programs and have a larger channel, that they're rich. I don't know about other ones. All I can do is speak for myself. And I did pass 100,000 subscribers many years ago. Okay, so I do have quite a few subscribers, but subscribers does not equal money. Okay, if you look at the amount of views that I have, I don't have hundreds of thousands of people watching my programs. I don't know what all those subscribers are doing, but they're not coming over here watching my programs. Those who do watch my programs, YouTube has what's called monetization, where they put ads on your programs, and every time somebody watches the ad all the way through or clicks on the ad, the person who has the ad on their programs, they get paid a couple cents, not very much at all. Well, the amount of income that you make from that has gone down. And that's because of YouTube changing all kinds of algorithms and rules and stuff, and advertisers are jumping ship. So the money that we used to make years ago, we're not making that now. I am actually making, okay, and I'm not going to mention how much I make. But I want to give you a scope of what's going on here, because that way you can appreciate where I'm coming from when I'm telling you about my website, trying to sell you seeds and things. If I were to, minimum wage here in Iowa is $7.85 an hour. I think it's $7.85 an hour, not much at all. If I went out and I worked a part-time job 2 days a week at minimum wage, 2 days a week, I would make more money than I make on YouTube. And you can figure that out. 8 hours a day times 785, 2 days a week, 4 weeks out of the month. Figure that one out. When you come up with that total, double check that total. And once you're done scratching your head, ask yourself, how does Ray survive on that? Well, Ray doesn't survive on that. Ray has patrons. And patron is one way for people to help donate to a cause. And some people will give you something on Patreon for donating. I can't afford to do that. So people who want to help, that is one avenue for them to donate to help keep things running up here on the farm. I didn't feel comfortable asking people to help. So what I did was I tried to find something that I could do as a business in order to help myself out, pick myself up by my own bootstraps. I made compost. And I was selling compost. That brings in a few dollars, but not a lot. I'm not making compost this year because it failed in the chicken coop. I started up with a little shop of seeds with just a few selections, and I'm growing it every single month. I make a little bit off of that. And how much is that? Figure out the minimum wage thing again, okay? So you can imagine how little I make. So I am not just a garden gnome. I am a very low-paid garden gnome. And I am just fortunate that Mike has a part-time job, and he doesn't make very much of that as well. So, but between us, we managed to make ends meet. Not griping, just telling you how things are. This is the facts of the matter. I never griped about my income. I never bragged about it. I never griped about it. I was raised poor by a poor mother. And so I'm okay with that. I'm okay with being low income. It doesn't bother me at all. I can survive. I can't survive as well as I could back when I had business, but I know I can't do that anymore. I know my limitations. So that's why I'm always promoting, trying to make a little bit of money here, a little bit of money there. And I appreciate every single sale that I get from people who buy from the seeds that I have to offer. You could buy anywhere else, but you know what? If you buy from me, you know where your money's going. Your money is going to pay for utilities, for food, to care for the dogs, for things that I need around here. Oh, well then, here comes a big old honking tractor. I'm just gonna have to talk above the tractor. But anyway, no, I don't make a lot of money. I am a very low income garden gnome, okay? And I'm very happy with that. But I do what I can to make a few dollars here and there. And so I do appreciate when people don't fault me for promoting my own seed shop and to ask people to help spread the word, because it does help more than you know, okay? Oh, FedEx, UPS. Why is UPS here? I don't know. Okay, hold on just a moment. I'll be right back. Oh, false alarm. Mike got it. Good. Things are happening today. Things are happening. Okay, let's finish this off, okay? Anyway, that's what I wanted to tell you about my income. A lot of people don't like talking about their income. I really don't mind. I don't mind. If people have questions for me, I have answers. And if you're asking that question, you want to know. So, you know, I don't give out my tax returns to people. But then again, I'm not ashamed of what I make. That's just the way life is. I'm not proud of it. I'm not ashamed of it. That's just part of what it is. But next one, Jeff. Hey, Jeff. What do you fertilize strawberries with and how often? Easy. Compost. And as far as how often to do it, when you start your strawberry bed, start out with a lot of compost in that soil. Strawberries are going to love you for it. Rich, well-drained soil. I say that a lot, but for strawberries, you need that well-drained soil. They love to not have their roots constantly moist, but they love a lot of nutrition. So what you do is you dig it deep, dig in some compost. Compost drains really well, and it also feeds your strawberries. Now, once you plant your strawberries, you don't want to bury the crown, which is the part that is right above the surface where all the leaves come out. Never bury that. It'll kill your strawberry plant. What you can do is, in the early spring, before they start growing, clear away all the clutter, all the leaves and stuff. If you have compost or you buy composted manure in a bag, spread that around your plants. Don't put it up against the plants. Spread it everywhere the plants aren't. Their roots will go out underneath the soil, and then as you water, the nutrients will go down and feed your plants. And he finishes that off with, I'm asking because I can never get strawberries to get as big as grocery store ones. Well, you know what, Jeff, and anybody else? You don't want those, okay? I've had those strawberries out of the store. And that's just like eating a big old red box of air. Those big, huge strawberries that are as big as apples, they're big and beautiful, and I don't know why they're such a big thing. I've eaten them, and they're hollow. You've been in those that are hollow? The ones I grow at home, they're not hollow. They're juicy in the middle, and that's the thing. The things that we grow at home are not going to compete with size and beauty of the stuff at the store. Those are built to attract customers. They're not built for flavor. Tomatoes? Nope. They're not built for flavor at the stores. They're built for shipability and for life on a shelf. That's what they're built for, but they're not built for flavor. It's the same with a lot of things. They're built for looks and size. Orange is as big as a baby's head. That's not real. The stuff we grow from our gardens, that's real. That's where you get the flavor. Ooh, birds everywhere. That's where you get the flavor. And so don't worry if your strawberries aren't big. As long as they're delicious, you're doing good. And if you give them compost, I point over there because that's where my compost pile is. If you give them the compost and you make sure they don't stay dry all the time, water them, let them dry. Water them, let them dry, and keep them in a sunny spot, you're going to get delicious strawberries and lots of them. They don't have to be as big, but you're going to get a lot. And that's good enough for me. Last one, Lori. Hey, Lori. Hey, Ray. So, they say radishes don't like fertilizer. I don't know who says that, but whoever said that lied to you. Anyway, on with the rest of your question. So, what do I use to grow radishes? All I ever get is leaves. Been like that for years now. Everyone says how easy it is to grow radishes. Well, don't listen to everybody. Everybody is just pulling your leg. I was told that too. And I used to fail at radishes. And now I have stellar success with radishes. And the secret of my success is the broken record, compost. I don't know who thinks that radishes don't like compost. They love it. And the thing is that people will say, don't put a lot of compost in with your radishes. And that's because they assume compost is a nitrogen source. It is, but it's also a well-balanced nutrient source. So what will happen is when you put compost in the soil, yeah, it gives them nitrogen. But unlike what people say, if you give them a lot of nitrogen, they'll grow nothing but leaves. Wrong. If you give them compost, it has a lot of nitrogen. It also has calcium, phosphorus, potassium, you name it, all that fun stuff. What your plant will do, they're not stupid. Plants will take that nitrogen, they will grow the leaves. They'll also take the other nutrients and grow the bulbs, the roots, the flowers, the seeds, the fruit. They use it in whatever amount that they need it. So you just give them, it's like giving them a buffet. And they know what to eat. Say, here, plant, take what you need. They'll take what they need when they need it, okay? So that's why compost is so good. It's not like I'm adding a fertilizer that's high nitrogen. I'm giving them everything that they need in an abundance. And that's why my radishes get big, beautiful leaves, and they also bulb up. Another key to doing your radishes, plant early. Very early in the season. As soon as the frost is over, or even right before the frost is over, get those seeds in the ground. Radishes love cool weather, and they hate afternoon sunlight. They love morning sunlight up to noon. They hate afternoon sunlight. If you give them a lot of sunlight, they're going to bolt, and that means they forego the bulbous root, and they just put out leaves, and then they put out the seed heads. That could be your problem as well. Get the compost in there, plant them early, water them well, keep the weeds out. They don't compete well with weeds. Keep the afternoon sun out, and I'll bet you anything, you, anybody who's listening, Lori, everybody else, you're going to get good radishes. French breakfast, those are my favorite. I'm planting those this year. I grow them every single year. I sell the seeds too. I only have one type of radish available, and that's French breakfast. Eventually I'll have others, but for right now, it's French breakfast on the website because they're mild, they're crunchy, they're big, they're fast growing. They're a wonderful radish. And you can use the leaves in cooking, salads. You can use the radishes, fresh eating, or throw them in soups and stews. You can use them. And also, if they do bolt and you don't get all of the bulbs, you know what? Don't worry about it. Let them grow. Let them put out their flowers, their tall stalks with flowers and seed pods. Get those seed pods. They're going to be long green seed pods. Bite into one of those. They are absolutely delicious. Grab a handful, sprinkle them, seeds and all, when they're green and tender on your salads or in your cooking, you're going to love your life. The minute you bite into those things, your life is going to be beautiful. They are delicious. So radishes are a multi-purpose plant. People think of them as just for bulbs, but if you think outside the box, you think outside a common thinking and don't listen so much as to what everybody else says and walk your own path, you're going to find that gardening can be a multi-dimensional, multi-flavor, multi-purpose type of thing. So that's my program today. And I hope you did enjoy it. I hope you learned a few things and had fun along the way. If you have any questions at all concerning your garden or anything, ask me in the comment section below. I will always be happy to give you my very best answer that I possibly can. I cannot guarantee I will have every answer for you, but I can guarantee I will do my very best to give you the very best answer I possibly can. That's my guarantee for you. Who is it this time? For living out in the middle of nowhere, I sure do have a lot of people driving by today. But anyway, I got to get going. Thanks for joining me. I really do appreciate it. I'll see you next week right here on the farm.